1 John chapter 2. My little children, we suppose John is towards the end of his life, an old Christian, a man who's walked with the Lord for years, addressing Christians, my little children. I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins. Not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. By this we know that we have come to know Him if we keep His commandments. Whoever says, I know Him, but does not keep His commandments, is a liar. And the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps His word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in Him. Whoever says he abides in Him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. So I'd like to look at these verses this morning. And what I want to do is remind you this. This epistle starts with an emphasis on fellowship with God. And you know what? John doesn't take it for granted. He doesn't anywhere through this letter take it for granted that all who claim to have fellowship with God actually do. Excuse me. For those who do, it's very clear. He wants you to know that you do. There's a lot about assurance here. He wants you to know that you know. He wants you to know that you are a Christian, if you are. But if you're not, He wants to expose you. That's what this book of 1 John is all about. We're really going to get into this all the more today. It's not like we weren't into it in chapter 1, but it just we're going to see this come after us, at us again and again and again, where He delineates between these two people. And if you are a Christian, He really wants you to see the proofs of it and the evidence of it. And He wants you to know it. He wants your assurance to be full. He wants there to be confidence. He wants you not to be a Christian that's filled with doubts. But if you're not one, He wants you to doubt. He wants you to doubt to the point of being exposed. He doesn't want you to be deceived. That's what we see going on here. Assurance, knowing. I mean, just flow through the book with me a little bit. Chapter 2, verse 3. By this we know that we have come to know Him. Look at verse 5. By this we may know that we are in Him. You drop down to verse 29. You may be sure. If you go to chapter 3, verse 14, we know that we have passed out of death into life. Chapter 3, verse 19, by this we shall know that we are of the truth and reassure our heart before Him. If you go to chapter 3, verse 24, by this we know that He abides in us. Chapter 4, verse 13, by this we know that we abide in Him and He in us. Chapter 5, verse 13, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God that you may know that you have eternal life. This is only part of them. But you get the flavor. The Apostle John wants us to know. In fact, if this is preached right, if it's preached according to the truth that's here, and if the Spirit of God uses this, true Christians really should come out the other side of this book more confident than ever. According to John, one of the most pronounced ways that a Christian can be assured, this is critical, Now, this isn't the only test. But John is assured that one of the most pronounced tests, assurances, that the Christian can be confident that they actually know God, it's based on the relationship that you have with sin. And if you haven't seen this thus far, I mean, look back at chapter 1, verse 6. If we say that we have fellowship him with while we walk in the darkness, what's that all about? Walking in the darkness. Does that have anything to do with sin? Certainly it does. If you say that you have fellowship with him while you walk in the darkness, that has to do with sin in your life. That has to do with the place of sin in your life. That has to do with a lifestyle. If that's the case, we lie and we do not practice the truth. If we walk in the light. You see, what is it going to have to do with it being brought into the light? The light of God, the light of God's Word. It means God's Word exposes us. We live in the light of that. It means that what we do is constantly in the light of right and wrong as far as the Word of God goes. But you keep going here in chapter 1, verse 7. If we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. The blood of Jesus, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. Verse 8, if we say we have no sin, again, notice the relationship with sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. In other words, if we say, you know what, we're just basically a good person. When we were lost, we were basically good people. You know, one thing that happens when you get saved, you come to recognize that in your lost years, you weren't a good person, you were a bad person. In fact, nobody gets saved, nobody needs the spiritual doctor unless they truly recognize they're bad. He came to save sinners. He didn't come to call the righteous. That's something that happens. Again, it's got to do with our relationship with sin and how we see it. And if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, again, our relationship to sin, what happens when you become a Christian? What does John say? Well, instead of denying that it's there, you recognize it's there, you hang your head because it's there, you're ashamed that it's there, you see it, and you recognize you need to have something done with it. And instead of denying it, what happens? You confess it. You go to God. You go to God to treat it. You go to God for the remedy. You go to God for forgiveness. You go to Him to confess it. And He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, when? When we do. You see, one thing about being lost is we have this knack for downplaying our sin. But that doesn't happen when suddenly your relationship to sin is much different. Why? Because you're in the light. You see things as they are. You see sin for what it is. You're in the Word of God. You're recognizing things are sin that you never recognized before were sin. If we say we've not sinned, we make Him a liar. His Word is not in us. You come over to chapter 2, verse 1. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. In other words, again, if you're a Christian, you may not sin. It's within the possible realm of reality that you don't have to sin if you're a Christian. But if anyone does sin, again, the relationship with sin, we've got an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. He's the propitiation for our sins. Our sins are propitiated. We have an advocate to deal with those sins. Not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. By this we know that we've come to know Him. What? If we keep His commandments. Keeping His commandments is opposite of what? It's opposite of sin. Doing His will is the test. All the way through here, you can see it. John knows this. Your relation to sin is a dead giveaway to who and what you are. Count on it. Bank on it. That's pretty much everything that he's dealt with thus far is your claim to fellowship with God is a lie if you don't relate to sin a certain way. The true Christian has such a radical and unique, new, and altogether different relationship to sin versus what the lost man has that John assumes this difference is highly visible, it's recognizable, it's discernible, and when identified, whether it's in us or not, if it's in us, it's a ground of great assurance and confidence, whether we've been truly saved and whether we know God. And you know, it's not like this. It's not just simply as simple as saying, well, when you're not a Christian, you sin, and when you get saved, you don't sin. That'd be pretty easy. That's not how it is. That'd be real easy. We just look around, who's perfect? And he could have done that. And yet, even though that's not the distinction, John does assume that whatever the distinction is in the relationship of the saved man to sin and the lost man to sin, it's so radically different that it's apparent and it's recognizable. He assumes that. What is it? How does it change? The picture that we get is that the true Christian walks in the light. Your word is a lamp unto my feet. The true Christian lives in the light of the Word. The true Christian sees life through the lens of Scripture. And so we begin to recognize right and wrong living in that light. And you know what we recognize? That when we see sin, we don't deny it. We don't say it's not there. We don't say we have no sin. Rather, we confess it. But the power of sin is radically broken, so that John can say, I write to you so that you may not sin. In other words, if you take the word of God and you use it in your life, you can apply it and not sin. You no longer are in bondage to it. Now, if you fail, our faith looks to Christ, and there's cleansing there. But if the pattern of your life is not one of keeping the commandments, you see, that's what happens. The very pattern of the life, the habit of the life, the character of the life becomes one of pursuing the will of Christ. That's what we see here in the commandments. John assumes that life is so radically different from the lost man that you can recognize it. We can recognize it. We can see whether it's true in ourselves. And if it's true, it really ought to assure us. God saved us. And that's where he's going with all this. So let's look at the first two verses first. I want to very quickly deal with this. John draws our attention to two truths about Christ in these first two verses that I want us to think about here at the beginning. My little children, am I writing these things to you so that you may not sin? But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father. Now, what's an advocate? An advocate is one who acts on your behalf. And the whole idea here is he ever lives to make intercession. That is necessary. That is necessary to keep you in a right relationship with God. You have sin. Christians continue to sin. The power of it may be broken, but there is still sin in the life. We still fall short of the glory of God. We still fall short of loving God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Even on our best day, we lack doing things with the whole full-heartedness that we should do it with. But that doesn't mean we're not radically changed. We are radically changed. But we have an advocate. And what happens? He's constantly interceding on our behalf with the merits of his own shed blood. He is constantly interceding so that what? Our fellowship is never broken. And there's propitiation. His advocacy rests on the fact that he has propitiated God. You think about that word. It shows up in Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3, we have the fact that he is this propitiation. We have this fact that God put forward Christ Jesus as a propitiation by his blood. What does it mean? Well, you remember how he starts as he describes man's problem. But the wrath of God is revealed against all unrighteousness and ungodliness of men. The wrath of God. That's the problem. That's what propitiation is all about. Propitiation is about appeasing God. It is about satisfying the justice of God. God's wrath burns hot against the sinner. Have you ever read in Scripture? If you don't believe, you are under the condemnation of God now. We were, in our lost days, children of wrath like the rest of mankind. Don't think because we believe in the doctrine of election that before you actually believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, somehow there's this eternal justification or this eternal removal of God's wrath against you. That's not right. That's not what Scripture teaches. Before you believe on the Lord, you were children of wrath like the rest. And if you've not yet savingly believed on Him, you're a child of wrath now. Your biggest problem is not ultimately sin or hell or the devil. Your biggest problem ultimately is God. God is against you. God is your enemy, and God is going to destroy you justly for your sins. And so what happens is Christ's advocacy works on this premise or on this basis. It works on the merits of propitiation. His advocacy, brethren, we need to get this. His advocacy for us in the very presence of God is He's at the right hand of God and He ever lives to make intercession for us. His advocacy is so potent because of the fact that He was made a propitiation for our sins. God's wrath fell on Him. He took it in our place. God is appeased and God is satisfied. And now none of it leaks through. It doesn't get past. The cup was put to His lips and He drained it. But now we look at this. And the question is, how can I be sure that God's wrath is not going to yet break forth against me for all the sins I've done in my life? And John tells us how we can be assured we're safe. I mean, that's the real question on the table. How can I know this is for me? How can I know His advocacy? I'll tell you this. Our salvation's no small thing. The advocacy of Christ, having a propitiation, that is not a little thing. And it behooves us to ask the question, how can I know that what Jesus did is for me? Well, let's look. Verse 3. By this we know that we have come to know Him. You want to come to know Him who's our advocate and our propitiation for sin. And by this you can know if we keep His commandments. Now, the first thing I want you to notice is John doesn't just... You know what's interesting? He doesn't say this. By this we know that we are Christian if we keep His commandments. You say, yeah, but isn't that what he means? Yeah, that's what he means. But it's interesting to me that that's not the terminology that he uses. He uses the idea of knowing Him. What's interesting about that is he uses terminology that's personal, that's intimate. You know Him. That's experiential. I mean, he wants us to not just know that we're Christian, but he wants us to know that we know God and know Christ. You remember, this is a big deal with John. In John 17:3, we have that, just that glorious eternal truth that this is eternal life. What? To know God, the true God, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, who was sent by that God. Do I know God? I mean, that's the question. Do I know God? Not just did I amend my life. You know, people do that. For one reason or another, people get scared. They get scared of hell. Something happens in their life and they feel like, you know what, I need to clean up my life. This isn't going good. I'm not sure that this is going to end up well if I just party my whole life away. That people come to periods in their life, they come to points in their life where they decide to go back to church. You know, there's people, when I was lost, I prayed to God. I remember my lost grandmother would say these prayers every night. I can remember her shouting from her bedroom as I was going to sleep out in the living room, you know, "Timmy, I'm praying for you." Or so, but you know what? That's not the issue. It's, do I know God? Has God broken into my life and revealed himself to me? Do I know this? Do I experience Jesus Christ on an intimate level, a real level, a personal level? John is not concerned that we simply believe some facts. You know, a lot of people believe that. Well, I believe in Jesus Christ. That's not what he's putting on the table here. He's saying, not do you know some facts. I know you know that he was born in Bethlehem, and I know you know these things, but that's not the issue. You can say, oh yeah, I know him. I know he died, and I know he rose on the third day. That's not what John's saying here. He's not saying you can know that you know him because you know these facts about him. Knowing him, intimate. Do you talk with Christ? Do you walk with Christ? Do you hold communion with him? You know, he told his disciples this. He said in John 14, yet a little while, he said, the world is not going to see me, but you're going to see me. And you know, Judas, not Iscariot, it says a few verses later, asked him, Lord, how are we? I mean, you're telling us you're leaving. You're leaving in a way that the world isn't going to see you anymore. But his disciples will see him. And Judas, not Iscariot, says, Lord, how is that? How is it that you're going to be able to leave? The world can't see you, but we will be able to see you. And he says, well, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. That sound familiar? Keep my commandments, keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Well, how? Well, that's a spiritual reality. He's going to manifest himself. For him to make his home with you is for him to manifest himself. What is manifestation? It means he's going to reveal himself to you. It won't be with these physical eyes, but he is going to make his presence known. If somebody lives in your home, he's going to make his home with us. Somebody lives in your home, you know they're there. I mean, even down to a cockroach, if it lives in your house, you get to know it's there. We have a little turtle living in our house. You know it's there. Things live in your house, you know they're there. We have two birds, you know they're there. You think the Almighty God is going to come and take up residency in your life and make a home there, and you're not going to know it's there? He's going to manifest himself. That's what he says. That's the idea. For John, knowing Christ, not just some head knowledge or theory, it's experiential. And what will be experienced if we truly know Christ? If we truly know Christ, you know what we're going to experience? There's going to be a reflex. There's going to be a response. And what is that? It is the reflex to obey Christ. You know how it is when you go to a doctor? Just recently when I went up to Missouri, Dr. John Barry, you know, they bring out that little hammer. And he was wanting to test me for stroke, so he was wanting to see if all my nerves and responses were right. Takes out that little hammer, and you know, he hits you under the knee. What happens? Bang, your leg goes forward. That's a reflex. This is what he's talking about. There's a reflex, and I'm not saying it's just automatic and you don't have to think about it. Certainly we think about it, but there's a response to knowing Christ. And what is it? He says it is obedience. That's what happens. The daily decision-making you make decisions every single day. You did when you were lost. If you've been saved, you do now. You make decisions. Well, what he's saying is this. The lost man by and large, and as a rule, and as a pattern of his life, he is constantly making decisions that do not involve the will of Christ. He's not concerned about it. Yes, he may look at the Ten Commandments. He may be aware of things like that. He may seek to actually cause outward conformity to things, but his heart isn't in it. He doesn't want it. It's an external rule of a list of rules that he kicks against. He doesn't like it. He forces himself not to do the things that he really loves. And you've seen the bumper sticker that says that. Everything that's what? Illegal, whatever. Those are the things that he likes to do. He's just being honest. That's how we were. But that's not what happens when we get saved. In fact, I was envisioning it like this. I can remember swimming in the ocean several times. You know when those riptides come in, when the tides are really strong, the waves are big? It can be very dangerous to get out in that water. But I remember doing body surfing, that kind of thing with buddies. And you think about it. You're standing there in the ocean. This is how the lost man is. You see those currents of water like Christ's will. Well, you're in there, and they're strong. But you dig your heels in, and you try to stand against them. But see, what the Christian does is he recognizes those waters will not pull him out into destruction. They'll pull him out into the depths of God's love. And he doesn't dig his heels in anymore. He lets them take him away. And that's what happens. The will of Christ is like that. The Christian sees that this is not a bad thing. He's come to know Christ, and he's recognized Christ's will is not bad for him. Christ's will is the most protective thing. It is the most loving thing. It is the most wise thing. And of course, what John's talking about is not just doing some external, you know, alterations to your life. It's not about the crazy wild man, wild woman, drunk, living this crazy life that just kind of cuts the drunkenness out, decides not to go to the parties anymore. This goes deeper than just deciding, well, you know what, I think election is true. It goes way beyond that. He's not just talking about that kind of thing. It's clear John has in mind, I mean, if you just look down, chapter 2, verse 29, you know that he is righteous. You may be sure that everyone who practices righteousness, that's another way of saying doing his will. His will is righteous. You do his will, you practice righteousness. And what is it an indication of? That you've been born of him. If you go to chapter 3, verse 9, no one born of God makes a practice of sinning. A practice of sinning is opposite to a practice of keeping his will, obeying his commandments. For God's seed abides in him, and he cannot keep on sinning because he has been born of God. You see, John has in mind more than just external fixes. He has in mind something that's deep, something that goes deeper than just deciding that Calvinism is right. Or deciding, you know what, I think homeschooling's a good thing. As good as those things may be, John has in mind here people who have all new changed desires. He's talking about people here who they have experienced the joy of forgiveness. Their eyes have been opened to see a hope in Christ. They have a sense of God's smile. And they, you know what, they're like Paul. They don't feel any longer, well, I just live my life and I do my thing. They recognize Christ is living in me. I feel it. There's a power at work in me that was never there before. My desires are different. I see the whole world different. I see Christ differently. He's speaking about a people who are aware of the power of God at work in them and changing them and producing this higher quality of life. They're new creations. They recognize that. Life more abundant. Something, all of a sudden, something is happening within them that's totally different than anything they've ever felt before. And they know Christ is responsible for it. Even though they may not be able to put it in terms, they know it. I'm different. I'm different. And Christ has done it. That's what he's talking about, life more abundant, the life of God in the soul of man. Isn't that what Paul talks about? That's what's happening. We sense it. We feel it. It's not just that we got religion. It's Christ has turned us into something new, something glorious. And the validity of all of this can be traced right back to watching your life. The validity of it. How can we know it's true? I mean, look at your life. We all have a life. We're living a life. We're making decisions. We all are. Look at your life. Is the great object of your life to be well-pleasing to Christ? Is Christ's will the ambition of your life? And look, in the men's theology class yesterday, we were sitting right in this area, and Brother Andre he brought up a situation about experiences. And you know, we can think about experiences. It's interesting. You hear the testimonies that people give. They're all different. Well, you know what? On Judgment Day, some will turn out to have been real, and some will turn out to have not been real. But you know, among all those that are real, there are a lot of different experiences that people have. Not all of ours are cookie-cutter things. It's not like you can do... But here's the thing. How can you tell if somebody's genuine? Well, John doesn't say, go examine their experience. Because if you're truly a Christian, then your experience when you were saved is going to look exactly like this. What I found is, the way God reveals himself to sinners is often different in different people. We were talking about how God was dealing with me over the course of from like October to July. And yet, I thought of the example of the guy that was walking home drunk on Sunday morning, and he just happened to be walking by the Metropolitan Tabernacle, stumbled in their back row, got saved. God deals differently. But you know what? We can take all of these experiences, and we can John says, get past the experience. Look at the life. You want to test the experience by Scripture? I mean, isn't this what John's all about? Beloved, do not believe every spirit. Test the spirits to see whether they're from God. You know what? People often have devilish experiences. But because the devil comes as an angel of light, sometimes it's very hard to tell a false experience from a true one. And then sometimes, you know what I found too? Well, I kind of get this from Hebrews chapter 6. It's very possible to be exposed to the work of the Holy Spirit and to conviction. Sinners can come under conviction. Sinners can come and sit they can hear a sermon on the radio. They can come into a church service. They can be very stirred. And yet that experience falls short of true salvation. But men confuse it for being that, you know, something happened and they think, wow, I got saved. Well, maybe they did and maybe they didn't. How do we examine all this? Well, we test the spirits. Test your life. Examine your spiritual walk. That's what John's saying. Look at verse 3. By this we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. The verb keep, it's in the present tense. It's indicating the general direction of your life. It's towards obedience, not disobedience. John's words from chapter number 1, verse 8, verse 10, chapter 2, verse 1, he talks about sin in our life. He talks about confessing that sin in verse 9. He says, I write to you that you don't sin, but if you do, we have this advocate. He's certainly not imagining perfection. That's not what this is all about. But it is also clear that John believes that the quality of one's life becomes so significantly changed in respect to the place of Christ's commandments that it's unmistakably clear who does and who does not know God. James, can you turn the thermostat down? It feels like it's becoming an oven in here. So, I want to stress something to you. Just make sure you see this. Somebody may misinterpret this. John is not concerned here with how we come to know God. You all get that, right? This does not have to do with how we come to know God. He's not dealing with how we become a Christian. He's not dealing with how we get regenerated. He's not dealing with how we get justified. He's not dealing with how we get our sins forgiven. He's not dealing with how. He's simply saying, if it has already happened, this will be the proof that it has happened. That's what he's talking about. Do you all see? John is not saying that if you want to know God and know Christ, that you need to obey him. You all see that. You all recognize that. John is saying, here's how you know that you already know Christ. Here's how you know. It's apparent by the way that you live. It can always be verified by your obedience. That's the issue. John is not teaching salvation by obedience. It can always be, and you know that comes up all the time. You're adding something to the gospel. You're adding. This was the big thing with John MacArthur when he wrote his book, The Gospel According to Jesus. What were the accusations that were being leveled against him? And this is ongoing. This has been ongoing in church history that people come along and they say, you have to repent. There needs to be this evidence in your life. There needs to be fruit. There needs to be an obedience to Christ. Well, you're adding works. You're adding works to grace. You're adding works to faith. No, we are saved by grace through faith. We are saved that way. We are saved with no confidence in ourselves. Our eyes looking to Christ and trusting what he's done. But the whole thing is, if you really are saved by him, you come to know him, then it doesn't leave your life the same. The kind of salvation that God offers to sinners is the kind of salvation that makes you obedient. That is the kind of salvation that is biblical. That is Christ's salvation. If you want to get saved, and what that means is you just simply want to somehow avert the flames of hell, but you're not really not interested in submitting yourself to the Lord Jesus Christ, that is not the kind of gospel he offers to sinners. Because you see, it's not really salvation. If he doesn't save you from your old ways, if he doesn't save you from doing things your way, you're not really saved, because your way, the wicked needs to forsake his way, because it's a wicked way, it's a bad way, and he takes us in a good way. And if you don't want to be saved from that bad, wicked way, you don't really want to be saved. We need to really get this. Do you obey God's word? Is the Bible daily holding sway over your conscience and your decision making? And you see the dynamics of all this. I mean, doesn't it make perfect sense? If you really know Christ, remember how in Ephesians 4 he says, if you have learned of Christ, if you have learned of Christ, he says, come unto me. He says, learn of me. Learn. If you know Christ, what do you find? I mean, if you really know him, not if you just know about him, but if you come to know Christ, what do you come to know about him? He's good. He has my best in mind. He loves me. I can trust him. I mean, if you say, I believe on the Lord, if you're saying, I trust him, you can trust him to totally take your life over and guide you. You see him totally trustworthy. You will take his commandments as the absolute most wise direction in your life. I mean, come on, when you come to know him, that's to admire him. That's to, if you truly know him. Why? Because he is beautiful. He is glorious. He is precious. He is all wise. And if you come to know him, you begin to come to recognize that. You will take his commandments as the absolute most wise direction for your life. You will believe his word to be the best for you. And you know what? He tests you in that, doesn't he? He will have you come to situations like Matt came to, where, and you can, there's a million different ways that this can happen in our lives. But what happens? He brings us to a place where obeying him is the hard road. Disobedience seems easier. But you see, it's really a test of faith. It's the good fight of faith. Because you know what it's saying? If he wants me to walk through the fire, I trust him that that is best for me. It's not about my agenda and my will in this thing. He calls me down a certain path, and He put me in these situations where my faith is challenged. He puts me in situations where disobeying is going to seem like it's going to seem like the way out. But if we truly trust Him, you know what we don't do? We don't lean on our own understanding. Lord, I'm going to trust You. I can't see the end of this thing. It looks bad. It looks like if I go down this road, the result is going to be bad. And usually bad for us means I'm going to have to suffer something. And you know what? He doesn't tell us that that's not going to be the end. But at the same time, He's showing us that the end of that path leads to all manner of glory. But the thing is, to know Him is to know something of His wisdom, of His honesty, His goodness, His love. And when you come to know that, for the first time, I mean, can you remember, brothers and sisters, your eyes are open, and for the first time, Christ takes your breath away. Christ is everything. You see it. He's not what He was before. Oh, you knew about Him. He was kind of a Christmas figure up on the wall on a crucifix, but now He is everything. And as we learn of Christ, what happens? It's not only we see Him precious, we see His commandments as gold, as life, as the ultimate good. Go to verse 4. Whoever says, I know Him, but does not keep His commandments, is a liar. The truth is not in him. I would just say this. There are some things in life that you really want to be sure about. Why? Precisely because so much rides on the outcome. I mean, whether or not you're obeying Christ is just such a matter. It's something you want to be certain about. It's a God-given test by which we may be sure of where we stand with God. You know what? There's really nothing else that matters more than that you are safe in Christ. Nothing that matters more to you. That is the most important thing of all. You don't want to take risks about your eternal destiny. You don't want to just shrug this off and say, I'm obeying Him. Just quiet your conscience. You don't want to do that. You don't want to take risks about your eternal destiny, especially when our Bible warns us that so many are deceived. So many. John expects them. You can tell. I mean, he expects them to be in our midst. So did John. So did Paul. Notice what is said here. Whoever says, I know Him. These are people whose lips say one thing, but then what happens? They don't keep the commandments. They say one thing, while their lives say another. Their very conduct invalidates their claim. That's what we get. They're liars. In other words, their error is not excusable. They're liars. It's not considered a legitimate oversight. They're liars. That may sound harsh. To say a person is a liar means what? You can't believe what they say. That's what he's saying. Don't believe what they say. You know, that happens in the church. We begin to ask somebody about their life. And a lot of times they throw out things like, well, you're just being legalistic. They say, I'm a Christian. We look at their lives and we say, you know what? Something doesn't seem right in your life. You're opposing God's word. You're going in a different direction. You're holier than thou. You're just being legalistic. Be very careful. These are strong words. But you know what he says? The truth isn't in them. We like to give people the benefit of the doubt. Well, we look at their life, it's not very impressing. There's not a lot of fruit there. There seems to be a lot of rebellion there. We like to give them the benefit of the doubt. John just kind of breaks through and says they're liars. He says it. They're liars. The truth isn't in them. The truth isn't in them. In other words, they say something with their lips, but that truth never got further than it comes out of their lips, but it's never sunk in. It's not in them. The truth isn't there. Wow, John's whole argument here, think about it. John's argument, he could not argue this way. If there were actually people who truly knew Christ, but could live in disobedience to the commands of Christ, he could never talk this way. You recognize that, right? He is absolutely excluding the possibility that you can have a true Christian who is living a life in opposition to Christ. Otherwise, you can't say what he says here. John's whole argument here is based on the certainty that knowing Christ always produces obedience. If a person could know God and still live in disobedience, then John would have no case here. The only reason he can say what he said, I mean, do you all see that? That may seem like a very easy thing. It may seem like you don't need high-tech logic to be able to figure that out. But isn't it amazing how many people, Jesus says in the end, are going to go to hell and they're going to be told to depart because they couldn't figure this out. As simple as it might seem and as clear logic as it might be, it's amazing how many men and women miss it and are going to perish because they refused to see it, they couldn't understand it, they didn't want to understand it, they didn't want to examine their life. Or when they did and they saw that it was concerning, rather than fleeing to Christ, they just determined to go on with their sin and hope in the end was just going to all turn out okay. And that is a fool's hope. You do not want to go there. If such a person existed that could actually be truly a Christian and live in defiance to the commands of Christ, then John would not be able to call someone a liar for claiming to be just such a person. They're a liar because it doesn't exist. It can't exist. It never will exist. And when somebody claims to be the Christian, but you look at their life and it's one that is not being held sway, held captive to the Word of God, if they claim to be a Christian, they're a liar. Notice how John points out these people, they say the right things. If you only look at this person based on what he or she says, they look good. You never discover them for what they truly are. These are people that tend to be in the right places. They tend to hang out with the right crowds. They say the right things. They talk the way a Christian talks. They say they know Christ. But something is fatally wrong. That's the problem. They lack the desire to do what Christ says. Christ speaks, and their lives are unchanged. When they see others do what Christ wants, they have excuses why they can't do it. Or they want to make you feel bad for doing it. You know, you don't deal with reality. You're being legalistic and you're setting up these standards, and they just want to explain Christ's commandments away. They want to be able to justify, well, I'm a Christian, you know, but I would just say this, what does your life say about you? Put it on the stand. Question it. Examine it. Look at it. John's not thinking here that this kind of radical transformation that takes place in a true Christian is so vague and undiscernible that if you examine it, you can't see it. He's assuming that it is so evident that you can see it, and it ought to be a grounds for assurance. That's what he believes here. You can see that. Look, to go on thinking you know Christ, why your life gives a lie to your profession. You just go on like that. Your doom is fixed. So take heed. I mean, do you not see? Brethren, keeping the commandments of Christ, do you see what that means? That means that if you willfully, of course, sin is willful, but let me add another word, habitually. If you habitually practice any sin, you've been discovered. Because I know this, God's not going to let you keep going in any sin. He is going to press your conscience. He's going to make your life miserable. He's going to lay the rod to your back. He's going to produce righteousness in his people. He's under covenant obligation. He tells us his promise is to conform us to the image of Christ. And I'll guarantee he is faithful to his promises. And if you can just willfully and habitually go on in some sin, you are in trouble. Because that means he's not treating you like a father. Be warned. Let's go to verse 5. Whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God. Now, this could be the love of God for us or our love for God. And I think it's our love for God just because it fits the context. Whoever keeps his word, that's an expression of our love to God. Remember how Christ said it? If you love me, keep my commandments. The love of God is perfected. I believe that this is our love for God is perfected as we keep his word. By this we may know that we are in him. And if you just glance down at chapter 4, verse 11 and 12, you get the same kind of thing. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, that's keeping his commandments. We're going to see that more as we go through here. The primary thing that John has in mind is that we love. If we love one another, God abides in us and his love is perfected. There's the same idea. As we love others, God abides in us and his love is perfected in us. That seems to be the perfecting of his love is us showing that love by keeping his commandments and by loving others. True love is not, think about this. There's a connection here between love and keeping his word. That's what Jesus says, right? If you love me, keep my commandments. And what... That connection is not difficult to figure out. True love is not expressed simply by flowery language. Now, there is expression like that, but it's not just expressed. How's it expressed? The proof of love to God and to Christ is loyalty. Loyalty. That's a nice word. When it comes to love, there's loyalty in love. Jesus says that if you love him, you will be loyal to what he has said. Let's go to verse 6. Whoever says he abides in Christ ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. I mean, John's logic is simple, is it not? If you say you're in Christ, in union with him, in oneness with him, what does it say? If you're that branch and you're plugged in to the vine, then you draw from him. You draw your life from him. You draw your sustenance from him. If you truly abide in Christ, you're connected to him. If you're connected to him, then what? Well, Peter says you're a partaker of the divine nature. That's a pretty crazy thing to say, right? A partaker of the divine nature. Well, I'll tell you one thing that's true about the divine nature as it's found in Christ. His will was to do the will of his Father. I mean, if there's anything about doing or having the divine nature in you, it's to love what God loves. It's to want to do what God does. It's to want to be righteous as God is righteous and holy as God is holy. We draw from him. How did Christ walk? I mean, if we abide in him, we should walk like he walks. In other words, if we're connected to him, we should begin to take the nutrients and the life from him that is going to make us like him. We are going to have the power within us to walk like he walks and to be able to imitate him and do the things he does. And what did he do? I'll tell you this. One of the things that he tells us repeatedly over and over and over is he came to do his Father's will. If you want to see how Christ is and how we ought to be imitating him, he came to do his Father's will. And this is why Scripture is very plain. It's not everybody that says to him, Lord, Lord. It's those that do the will of his Father in heaven that are going to actually enter the kingdom. Why? Because if you're abiding in Christ, if you're drawing from Christ, if your life is being drawn from Christ, what's in that? I mean, it's like his blood flows out of him into you. It's going to make you like him. It's transforming. There's a transforming power that is being drawn from him to you. And if you're in Christ, you're going to become like him. Power, life, sustenance. What it's going to do is it's going to equip you to be able to walk the same way he walked. And how did he walk? I'll tell you this. He walked in the power of the Spirit. He was led by the Spirit. He walked with a desire to please his Father. I mean, can you see him out there? I mean, he would go out and he would cry out to his Father. He loved his Father. He drew from his Father. He needed his Father. He was dependent on his Father, crying out to his Father. He showed us by example, how we should live. And John is saying that if you're in him, then you have power to imitate his walk. And if you don't imitate his walk, it shows you can't and don't abide in him. Are you going to say you abide in him? Are you really going to say that? If abiding in him is so radically, if it so radically changes the life, are you going to say that you abide in him unless you're actually on a regular basis imitating him? Looking at what he did and how he was in Scripture, looking at how he walked, looking at how he was, he showed us by example how we should live. John is saying that if you're in him, you have the power to imitate his walk. John's saying that if you're in him, you have the power to do that day by day throughout your life. If the basic flavor of your life is not similar to that of Christ, that's what you have to ask yourself. From the time you believe you got saved, can you look at your life and see, yes, my life is becoming conformed to the Lord Jesus Christ. I go to the Word of God. I see who He is. I draw from that. I trust Him. I believe in that Christ. But also I see in Him a way of life. And I have a desire to live it. And I feel the power of Christ Himself in me, giving me the ability to live that. It's not always easy. There's a battle in it. Oftentimes I have to go against the devil and I have to go against the desires of my flesh. But at the end of the day, I want to live like Him. I long for when I won't have that flesh tearing me down, backing me off, fighting with the devil, the distractions. But the goal of my life is to live like Him. I want to live like Him. I'm asking Him for strength to live like Him. I'm seeking to abide in Christ by faith. I look to Him. I go to His Word. I'm living on Him. I'm feasting on Him. I drink His blood. I eat His flesh in faith. I go to Him. I look back at the cross. I draw power. There's resurrection power there. I see in that the basis of my hope, the merit of Christ. I go there. My trust is there. And trusting Him, I go forth seeking to imitate Him. Is that your life? Did something like that happen? Is it happening in an ongoing way? If it's not, this is bad. We need to honestly assess whether or not we're genuinely in Him, abiding in Him. Christ's food, He said, was to do the will of His Father, to please His Father. He was not a man pleaser. He was a God pleaser. And He would please God before He would please man, even if man frowned on Him or even when they crucified Him. He was going to do the will of God above all. Do we see Him? I mean, are we captivated by what Christ did? Do we find it beautiful? Do we look at Him and we see His love for God, His love for sinners? Do we look at Him and see His honesty? We see His truth. We see His purity, His compassion, His sympathy. Oh, His heart weeping, tears, the patience, loving kindness, tenderness, sacrifice. He laid down His life for others. Do we see that? And do we seek to imitate? Everyone who's united with Christ is going to express that union with Christ by living like Christ. John says it so. John is under inspiration. God says it so. These things are not matters to be argued about. They really aren't. We must just come face to face with what John's saying here. Face the facts. This is what he says. You cannot be receiving the life of Christ without becoming like Christ. Christ is not at work within you. Christ is not dwelling within you unless you're becoming like Him. You cannot walk with Christ, deeply know Christ, commune with Christ, without what? Without loving Him. True love always is going to manifest itself in this loyalty. You can't really walk with Him and commune with Him without your face. Like Moses, when he walked with God on that mount, with your face beginning to shine forth the same glory. If you're in His presence, you cannot live in His presence without becoming like Him. He has a presence that is transforming. This is just a truth, and we got to face the facts of it. This is the way it is. This is not up for argument. This is the way it is. And again, he's not calling for perfection, but certainly this ought to be so clear in your life. This ought to be so radically different from how you were when you were lost that you can clearly identify the one from the other. If this is shady, if this is kind of a gray area, if it's not really clear, look, I'll tell you this, Christ is your only hope. Christ is your only Savior. You run to Him, you plead to Him, you cry out to Him, you confess to Him. You take all I mean, he is the Savior. I can point you no other place. You go to him. You go to him for rescue. You go to him for help. You go to him. But test yourself. Don't be deceived. And if you suddenly come to the realization, I am deceived, what do you do? In desperation, flee to him. I mean, it ought to be like Peter when he was walking on the water and suddenly he began to sink. You suddenly see, I'm sinking. What did he do? Lord, save me. If suddenly God opens your eyes to this, that you're going under, that you're not in a safe place, the billows are ready to swallow you up. What do? Cry out, Lord, help me. Save me. Well, could we pass out the elements to the Lord's table?